Welcome to Cockpit Conversations.
Thank you, Dad.
We get a friend here, Courtland Savage. So we won't be in the cockpit today. But while I have Courtland Savage here, Courtland, you know I use Cockpit Conversations to put out authentic information about entrepreneurship, about real estate, about banking, about credit, all those things that I think that are important to people's overall financial success, if you will. Having you here makes me want to talk about flying airplanes. And so I want to hear about why you started Fly for the Culture and where are you taking it?
I started Fly for the Culture because I was in the Navy as an officer flying F-18s, and I was one of the two black pilots in the entire squadron. So I thought to myself, I want to change that. One of the reasons I feel like there's such a lack of diversity is the young people of color aren't being introduced to it. There aren't pilots that look like them coming to their high schools and telling them they can become pilots. So I wanted to utilize my youth and my knowledge of social media. So I just started an Instagram, started taking my little cousins on introductory flights and posted it on Instagram. And also resharing other pilots' photos. ABC caught what I was doing and decided to put me on their show More in Common, and the rest is history. So that's what I've been doing, Fly for the Culture, utilizing social media and basically meeting the young people where they are.
So, you know, the goal for me in Cockpit Conversations is to talk about and expose people to something different. You're doing the same thing with Fly for the Culture, is you're exposing young people to something different, because I believe, and I think you believe, it's easier to be it if they can see it.
Definitely. Sometimes you got to see it to believe it. Even in a case like we just got back from the Bahamas, I never met a black multimillionaire. So now I met a black multimillionaire. I got to hang out with a black multimillionaire. Now I know I can be a multimillionaire as well.
Exposure means a lot. Exposure helps you set goals, if you will. I mean, you talked about the trip to the Bahamas. There was a person who took me to the Bahamas the first time about 15 years ago and exposed me to it. We flew down in his plane. We hung out on his boat. And I got back and said, man, I got to get back and work real hard. And I set that as my goal, to have a boat in the Bahamas, to fly my own plane down to the Bahamas. And so I'm just paying forward, if you will, what people have exposed me to. I think the other thing that I like about Fly for the Culture is when you introduce young people to aviation, you're also providing them with some mentorship on how to become pilots. Can you talk about that as well?
Yes, I provide mentorship through social media. So young people shoot us a direct message through Instagram, even on TikTok. You can even go to the comments on TikTok on one of my videos and you can see me answering questions to the young individuals. So basically, I've been mentoring, utilizing social media, because I know young people are always on their phones. So once again, I'm just meeting them where they are.
So how many pilots do you think you're gonna create over the next 5 years via Fly for the Culture?
For the next 5 years, how many pilots I create? I would say 100. I'm going to create 100 pilots.
That's awesome. So give me some nuggets on how to be successful on your journey to becoming a pilot.
Like, pretty much kind of like you said, just stay focused, stay dedicated, keep grinding, don't give up. You only fail when you give up.
Yes.
So just keep grinding, stay in the book, study, discipline yourself, and just keep going. And that's simply all it is. It's not hard to fly a plane. It's easier to fly on a plane than it is driving a car. The plane flies itself. So all you have to do is discipline yourself, sit down, study, and you'll get right through it.
Gotcha. And so, you know, one more question I got for you, and I know the answer, but tell the audience, how old do you have to be to get your pilot's license? I think a lot of folks will be shocked.
You can actually solo at the age of 16 years old, and you can get your private pilot's license like me at the age of 17 years old.
There's a lot of young people I don't trust driving my car at 17, but you can get your pilot's license at that age.
Yes.
That's kind of crazy, man.
It is. I actually, after high school, I got my private pilot's license at the age of 17. So I would take my friends after class flying around to Charlotte And, you know, I just got my license as well. So we'll fly around to Charlotte Airspace. Yeah, that's you can get your pilot's license at 17. I did it, and it only took 3 months.
And so let me ask you one more question. You know, for anybody in the audience who wants to get their pilot's license or who wants to send their kid to get their pilot's license, where are the best places to go to find a flight school? Is it the local airport? Where do you recommend that they go?
Google. Just Google flight school, and it's literally the nearest flight school is going to pop up. And then if you want to ask questions about that flight school, you can send us an email or a direct message through social media, and I'll simply go through it and see what type of flight school there are and tell you if it's a good one or a bad one or you should look into something else.
What does it typically cost to get your private pilot's license?
It typically costs anywhere from $9,000 to $11,000. Fortunately, Max Maxwell donated us a Piper Cherokee, and now we're able to lower the pilot training cost with the donation of the aircraft down to anywhere from $7,000 to $8,000.
Well, ending this cockpit conversation with Courtland Savage, do you have any questions of me?
So, Daryl, we was in the Bahamas, and you talked about flying to Africa. Can you talk to me a little bit about that? You going to fly a PC-12 all the way to South Africa?
I am going to fly a PC-12 all the way to South Africa. I've already flown the PC-12 to Egypt. And so when I sold my last company, my wife and I took some friends to Egypt, but we left Nashville, went to Bangalore, Maine, to Newfoundland, to Greenland, Iceland, Scotland, Florence, Italy, Crete, and then over to Egypt. And we were going about 21 days, but you know, one of the things about aviation that I love, and I love that you're exposing young people to it, is because in a plane, you can go anywhere. And so when you're exposing them to aviation, it really opens up their world. As a kid, there were no pilots where I grew up. There were no bankers where I grew up. There were no millionaires. There were no people that I knew flying, you know, to Africa. Where I live, people took their showers when they came home from work. So here I am, flying my plane, you know, flying my plane to Africa. And so, yeah, that was a great trip. About 75 hours flying time there and back. A great trip. On the way back, we stopped in Santorini, Greece, Mykonos, Greece, over to Malta, back up to Venice, Italy back up to Scotland. And we're going to do it again when COVID is over. I want to take it all the way down to South Africa and actually stay a couple months down there. But we're going to use general aviation, use the regular piloting skills that you're teaching kids to have. I'll use those same piloting skills to cross the Atlantic twice.
Wow, that's impressive. Also, I noticed when we were in Bahamas, you mentioned that you provided all the masks for the locals on the island. Is that true?
Yeah, so when COVID hit, as you know, our second home is in the Bahamas. And, you know, oftentimes resources are tough to get down there. So I contacted the representative down there, and I asked him what did they need. His name is Chester Cooper. He asked him what they needed, and he said masks was one of the things, and then hand sanitizer and all those kinds of things. But I flew down enough masks for everybody on the island. And so there was no excuse for any of the Bohemians and the Exumas not to have a mask, because I think I flew down there 6,000 or 7,000 masks for them to have, along with some other materials. But one of the things that I like doing with the PC-12 is, you know, it'll carry a lot of weight. And so I did 7 humanitarian trips to the Bahamas after this past hurricane, where I took generators, supplies, food, Pampers, diapers, clothing, you name it. Took those things to the Bahamas. I did that 7 times. And then also, the previous hurricanes down in San Juan, Puerto Rico, and St. Thomas, I flew medical supplies down there as well. Hurricane, I think, Mike in Panama City, I used it to fly medical supplies down there and brought people back. And so I use aviation for business, but some of my best trips have been humanitarian trips, where I'm actually doing something to help somebody out. And then also, you know, kind of like Fly for the Culture, I've taken hundreds of young people flying. And so I would say that 70% of the passengers that have been on my plane, I don't know them. But that's what it's for. It's to expose people to aviation. It's to help people out in difficult times. Thank you for being on Cockpit Conversations. Thank you for the stuff that you're doing for aviation to expose young people to this industry. And I think it's going to be awesome for me and for you to pull up to an airport and see five or six African-American pilots, you know, men and women at the FBOs.
Oh, yeah.
So
definitely.
Thank you for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
We'll be right back.